I'm so excited to talk about grass today, specifically, because I'm going to...
Because grass class is in session.
Yes, because grass class is in session. So welcome to grass class, if you're just tuning in. I'm Daryl. I'm a sustainable landscape designer. I help clients in Utah and also virtually nationwide swap out boring, ugly grass lawns into efficient, beautiful native landscapes. So we're going live today just to chat through some things. Because I'm actually going to be walking through several hundred, if not several thousand of you, through how to unalive, is the term we use now on the TikTok, I think, and on Instagram, how to replace a Kentucky bluegrass or otherwise inefficient lawn with something beautiful and native, or at least a garden, or just something generally more practical than grass. So I have my friend Lee here with me. He's going to be reading off some questions, and... that's all I have. So I think we should just jump right into it. I'm going to take my first sip of wine now.
Okay. So how do we feel about the clover lawn trend?
I like clover. Clover's great, but I think it comes with caveats. So the issue is if you try to just have clover and nothing else, oftentimes it will not hold up to foot traffic. So it really depends on if it's just a front yard where people aren't going to be really walking around, or if you have five dogs that are going to be tearing up your yard, in which case I'd recommend reinforcing a clover lawn with a mix of other more resilient things. I also find that because clover is a nitrogen-fixing plant, if you don't have something non-nitrogen fixing with it to have sort of a symbiotic relationship, eventually there's just too much nitrogen in the soil and it starts to get a little lilty and a little lifeless. So I actually really like a clover grass mix. And believe it or not, there are studies and academic papers out there about how both grass and clover do better when planted together. So I almost never recommend an entirely clover lawn, but I do recommend mixing them together. I think it's PT Lawn Seeds that has a low water eco lawn blend that is clover, grass, and also yarrow. Yarrow is incredibly xeric, drought tolerant, and also holds up to foot traffic amazingly. And so that mix together is really, really resilient, both drought tolerance and in like foot traffic wise. And it only requires a mow about once a month. So in general, you know, if I were to compare a Kentucky bluegrass lawn where you have to water it so much and then you have to mow it literally every week or it starts to look incredibly messy, it's like a no-brainer to me. It's such an improvement. So that's how I feel about clover.
So yarrow, a lot of people think of yarrow like when it's mature and it's really long and, mm-hmm. and woody. So when it's yeah. when it's short, it's just...
Yeah, yarrow actually makes an amazing ground cover. And if you are in Utah, the Conservation Garden Park has awesome displays of completely just yarrow as turf. Because while it does grow tall, it starts to flower at about 18 inches tall and can be up to 2 or 2.5 feet tall. It is a slow grower. So if you mow it once a month, you're able to keep it down as a ground cover and you'll have a lawn at 2 to 4 inches tall that's incredibly resilient. And it's awesome because it's also a native plant. So while there aren't many native grass options or native turf options, it's nice to see these eco mixes that at least have yarrow.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right, that Alice B. If you already have a normal lawn, how do you switch over to a lawn alternative? Is it just as easy as throwing down seeds?
Okay, so...
And is this a dumb question?
It's not a dumb question, Alice. Oh my goodness. It's the question. It's what we're here to talk about. Okay, so I'm going to repeat the question back just so I make sure I'm clear on what Alice is asking. Alice is asking, if I already have an existing lawn... Mm-hmm. How do I replace it with something better and smarter?
That's the one.
She's saying. And can I just throw down seeds?
Yep.
That is one of the options. And there are four options that I recommend that are ecologically favorable to swapping out your lawn from something terrible and stupid to something beautiful and amazing. And those options, I'm going to go through all four of them. You've got solarizing, sod cutting, solarizing, sod cutting, sheet mulching, and also overseeding. So there's a lot of S's. Seeding, solarizing, sod cutting, sheet mulching. Yeah, all of those things. So the simplest of those that you were mentioning is to just throw down some seeds, right? there are a couple of caveats, because Kentucky bluegrass, which is what we have the most here, but whatever lawn blend you have, it's thriving already. So we want to be able to give the new seeds a chance to eventually overtake the Kentucky bluegrass. So in that case, what I would recommend is mowing the Kentucky bluegrass down very, very short, about as short as you can get it. You might need to do like a longer one and then a second pass at a lower setting, and then keep it short for several weeks, because actually the root health of Kentucky bluegrass is directly correlated to blade length. So if you have Kentucky bluegrass that you're letting get long, that is stronger and more resilient than if you're cutting it down super short. So mow it repeatedly, like, you know, two or three times a week for 2 weeks to keep it really, really short, and that's gonna weaken it significantly. Then what you can do is aerate the lawn, because that's going to punch those cores into the lawn and allow those seeds that you overseed it with to penetrate down and get into the soil and have that soil contact. And then the third thing you can do is get a hard rake, and you've been keeping that lawn really short, so you can give a really tough rake to the ground cover or to the grass. And that's gonna, again, allow for more seed contact. Now, the thing that you need to know is once you overseed it, you're gonna need to water frequently in order to allow that seed to germinate. And it's gonna be like 5 to 10 minutes a day, every day, because you don't wanna water too deeply, because that'll suffocate the seeds. And then you have this sort of awkward balance where you're trying to get these new seeds to germinate, but now the Kentucky bluegrass is like thriving because you're watering it so much. So there's gonna be this awkward stage where you still have to mow quite a lot. You still have to kind of deal with the fact that this Kentucky bluegrass is doing its thing. What will eventually happen is the eco blend that you overseed with will start to establish, and then you can dramatically reduce the amount that you're watering. And then once you reduce it to be in line with what this drought tolerant variety wants, the Kentucky bluegrass is gonna start getting really weak. But I would recommend overseeding every spring and every fall, probably for 2 or 3 seasons before you're gonna have a completely new lawn. So it's not an instant fix. There are definitely more invasive things, like things that require more upfront work that would get you this lower maintenance lawn faster. And we can talk about those next, if people are interested.
Yeah, absolutely.
Is anyone here?
Yeah, we've got quite a few people have checked in. We've got a handful of people watching. So definitely let's look into those more invasive techniques, those upfront.
Great. So we covered of the four ways that you can swap out a drought tolerant, or sorry, a water thirsty and inefficient lawn like Kentucky bluegrass with something that is low maintenance and low water, which is what we want. Or switch it out completely for something different, like native plant landscape or a garden, whatever. If you want to get rid of your grass, there are four ways you can do it without spraying harmful chemicals that are going to leach into the water supply, because we don't like doing that. This is an anti-Roundup account, okay? I don't care if they're going to come for me. I'm not here to support Monsanto. I'm just not. So we're not spraying Roundup, so what we have to do instead are one of these four ways. We just covered overseeding, and then the other three S's are solarizing, sod cutting, and sheet mulching. Which one should we talk about firstly?
Solarizing.
We should talk about solarizing. Okay, so this is basically heating up the grass so much to effectively unalive it, so that you can then rake it up really good and overseed a new variety. So that involves some plastic. I, of course, don't love just buying a big roll of plastic that's going to end up in the landfill. It's not my favorite option. However, I have just used old shower curtains before. So when your shower curtain is getting mildewy and you don't like it anymore and you're going to replace it, put it to the side and then use it when you're ready to start your solarization product. And then we're reducing, reusing, recycling, all of those things. So you're going to lay that down over your grass. Again, you want to get your grass pretty short so that there's none of this like air pockets. You know, if you have really tall grass, then you're gonna have that. So get your lawn really short, lay the plastic down on top, and then either use landscaping staples to secure it, or you can like put some bricks or rocks or something to secure it. And then you're gonna leave it there for like 6 solid weeks, or maybe even up to 8 weeks. So the downside of this is that you just have to have grass or plastic out on your yard for a long period of time. It's also important that you wait for temperatures to get quite high. So this isn't something I would recommend doing right now if you're in the Northern Hemisphere like I am. I would say June would be a great time to start, and then you could have that be down all summer long, which would be a perfect time to then seed your new lawn in October or September, maybe even late August, depending on what your climate is, and giving that the time to establish before the frosts come, and then you're gonna have this amazing lawn fill in the spring. So solarizing is great if you're cool with taking all summer and you're ready to be patient. It's minimal work in terms, like you put down the plastic, then you don't have to do much after that, and then you just rake it up and put your seeds down. So it's probably the lowest effort of all of them, but you just have to deal with the fact that plastic's on your lawn for an entire summer. And I, you know, it's not my favorite option for that reason.
So what is your favorite option?
That is a great question. I think overseeding, it really depends. So if you already have a lawn that's doing okay and you want to keep using it, overseeding is one of my favorite options because it's just, it's a slow transition. Eventually it becomes what we want it to be. The only issue is you do have to continue the level of maintenance that your current lawn requires for probably an entire season before next season it's going to be good enough. I would say sheet mulching is one of my favorite options, but I would not recommend it if you were just going to seed a new lawn on top of it. I would recommend it if you were going to put down a garden, raised garden beds, or you were going to plant a native landscape and plant perennials into the ground. And for sheet mulching, it is exactly what it sounds like. You're going to take cardboard or contractor paper. Cardboard is obviously free, but you have to have somewhere to store all this cardboard as you're saving your boxes, or you have to go sweet talk a Best Buy employee to give you all of their cardboard or something like that. Contractor paper, not free, but fairly inexpensive, and you can get a roll of it at Lowe's or Home Depot, and then you just like put a brick on it or stick a landscaping staple on one end and you just walk it back and just roll it out, which is what I've done in the past. I've done cardboard too. It just really depends if you have the patience to save all the boxes or not. And then you just put compost and wood chips on top, and you could immediately, if you wanted, plant perennials directly into that and then let that fill into the native landscape. You could also do that in the fall and kind of let that just sit, and like the wood chips are going to start breaking down and all this microbial activity is going to start working as that saprophytic fungi starts working. So you could do that and then plant in the spring. I've also seen folks plant directly into the lawn and then do the sheet mulching around the plants, which I think is fun because then you don't have to worry about like breaking the paper or cutting through the cardboard. You just place it down around the plants. And then sod cutting, I think, is fairly self-explanatory. It's definitely the fastest solution in terms of you can sod cut and then you could seed your new lawn the next day.
Wow.
But you have to rent a sod cutter or hire a crew to do it. You have to call in blue stakes to make sure that you're not going to damage any utility lines. You need to be careful that you're not going to damage any underground sprinkler system. So I think it just, you know, requires a little more research and a little more confidence than the other ones. Those are all of the ways that you can effectively get rid of a Kentucky bluegrass lawn and then eventually replace it with something way better.
Right, which we can cover some other options for. Mm-hmm. We have Deanna Driscoll wants to know what grass works best for Oregon, where the sun shines, maybe, but it rains a million days a year.
Yeah, I would say, Deanna, you need to check out PT Lawn Seeds. They're based in Portland. I recommend them a lot. I did email them about maybe a little sponsorship situation and did not hear back. So PT Lawn Seeds, if you're listening, I like you, but they are great eco-friendly company. They have low maintenance blends, low water blends. They have blends that are just fescues. So they have meadowy, fescues are fun because they grow to like 6, 8, 10 inches tall, but they flop over in these beautiful sort of patterns. So it looks like very Hobbit, very New Zealand, very rolling hills, very bright green, beautiful. And they also have that eco lawn blend, like the one I was talking about previously, which is clover, grass, and yarrow mixed together. And I really, really like it.
Nice.
They have a bunch of really fun ones. They've got a forage blend. So if you have chickens or anything, you can actually put a lawn in place that's nutritionally valuable for them. And they're local to Portland. They rent out the tools that you need to install your lawn, which I think is really rad. They're affordable. that's definitely a big recommendation for me. And even for the non-Pacific Northwest clients, I end up usually referring them out to folks and then just have them ship it in because I think it's a great company.
Awesome. Well, on Instagram here in our live stream, Wilbur and King wants to know if wood chips add or take away nitrogen from soil.
I'm so happy you asked that question. Technically, they take it away, but I could talk. Do you see my books? Here's a book that we can talk about that. And look. I have two. Okay, so do wood chips take away nitrogen from the soil? Technically, the wood chips don't. Technically, bacteria does. So what happens is wood chips are a carbon-based material. And in composting or just in nature in general, you have carbon and you have nitrogen. And you need equal parts of both in order for organic material to turn into compost. So if you put down a bunch of wood chips in the soil that's high in carbon, and then the bacteria that would come in and start to break down, like the decomposer bacteria, also decomposer fungi, but in this case, it's primarily bacteria. They come on and they're like, let me start eating this. But then in order to like break down the carbon, they have to use the nitrogen to do that because that's how decomposition works. That's how composting works. So essentially they tie up the nitrogen. And the phrase tie up is there because it's not that they remove nitrogen from the soil. It's not that your nitrogen severely decreases in level. It's that the nitrogen is not bioavailable while the bacteria are breaking it down. So what I highly recommend are a couple of different options, but I'm going to start with what I do not recommend. And what I do not recommend, especially in raised bed gardening, is putting logs in the raised beds. And I'm seeing you people on Instagram, I'm seeing you garden influencers filling up your garden beds with logs thinking, oh, this is so great. The logs are going to break down and they're going to like save me so much money on raised bed soil and whatever. It's going to take 15 years for that log to fully decompose. And I made that number up, but I do actually think it's probably close to 15 years. It's going to take 10 plus years for that log to decompose. And for that 10 plus years, nitrogen at, you know, whatever level, I don't know if it's a, nitrogen at some level is not going to be bioavailable to your plants. And that's a problem. So what I do strongly recommend is that you put a layer of wood chips in the garden bed, because it's the same thing as if you were trying to compost a big stick versus like, you know, a bunch of little shredded pieces of paper. The shredded pieces of paper are going to be compost the next season. The stick is going to take years. So the wood chips will break down significantly faster. And while you will see a decrease in bioavailable nitrogen, it will pop back up significantly faster. And then that saprophytic fungi and the decomposer bacteria that like to eat the wood chips are going to create this like absolutely delicious soil structure eventually. So you will end up with better soil than if you didn't include wood chips at all, but you will see a decrease in nitrogen in the short term. Just don't do a log, because then the short term becomes long term. So what I would recommend to combat that short term nitrogen, decrease in nitrogen, is to either plant a nitrogen fixing cover crop as like your first season in the garden bed. So you can do any sort of clover cover crop, or they sell them. If you just Google nitrogen fixing cover crop, that's gonna be like the absolutely best thing you could do. If I could tell anybody how to start a garden from scratch, if they had the time, I'd say this season, or even like this fall, and then you can do your gardening next spring. Excuse me, this has bubbles in it, and that's not great for being live. Whoa, it's like coming up. I would do a bunch of wood chips, like not a bunch, but like less than a quarter of the entire raised bed. But let's say 1/4 wood chips, 1/4 compost, and then a bunch of raised bed soil or something, topsoil, native soil, it could be a mix of things. Mulch that with wood chips or leaves or some other sort of carbon material on the top. And then I would plant in there a nitrogen fixing cover crop for an entire season or for the winter. And then you could chop and drop that and plant into it in the spring. What you're going to have a year later or even 6 months later is just some dynamite soil, but it takes time. If you are in a hurry, if you want to be getting that like garden dopamine immediately, which I understand, then I would say just you have to be supplementing with additional nitrogen. And my favorite organic fertilizer company is Down to Earth Fertilizers, and they have plenty of garden mixes where you can sprinkle that around. I hope that answers your question.
Awesome. All right, two questions about buffalo grass, which we've a couple of videos on our YouTube channel actually cover. Okay. Buffalo grass.
Yeah.
Gabrielle Meredith 13 says, I'm interested in the buffalo grass and have seen some stuff about mixing it with 10 to 20% clover or micro clover. What's your opinion on that? I can already tell.
I don't recommend mixing a warm season grass with clover or a cool season grass. I don't recommend over like trying to mix your existing lawn with buffalo grass. Buffalo grass is amazing because it's a native turf grass. It's the only turf grass that's actually native to the United States. And it's native to the Western United States, basically from Montana to Mexico. Fabulous. It's basically xeric. It does not need to be mowed really at all. I love this grass. However, it's a warm season grass. And what that means is it goes dormant in about October. And it will be sort of brown, brownish gray for the entire winter until it starts to wake up in about April, and it really won't be looking green and lush until May, depending on your climate, maybe even June. Now, I'm personally okay with that because of all of the benefits, but some people aren't, because if you look outside right now, it's April, grass is green. Right. The grass is grassing outside. And some folks would be sad to have like a gray lawn at this point. I'm getting a little bit distracted from the question, but it's a warm season grass, so they have completely different, they have like different growth times, and it's not going to blend nicely. They're different colors, they're different textures, they're different heights. So aesthetically, I think it would be quite awkward. And they also grow at significantly different rates. So I would highly recommend mixing clover with a cool season grass like that Eco Blend I was telling you about from PT Lawn Seeds. Buffalo grass, honestly, it does great on its own. I would recommend if you're going to do a turf grass lawn that you want to be incredibly xeric, incredibly low maintenance, just commit to the buffalo grass. You do need to remove your lawn pretty much completely. So sod cutting or solarizing would be the two that I would say you should do for that. And then you would buy plugs because again, it's a very slow, it's a slower growing grass. So you're not gonna overseed, you're gonna actually install plugs. And then it will take about a season for those plugs to fill in and become a lawn.
Gotcha. So the second question is from Jonathan Roca. Wants to know what zones will buffalo grass thrive in. Lives in a town where the growing zone is 9 and climate zone is 14. Thank you.
That sounds great. So buffalo grass, it's zone 5 and higher. So I would not recommend it anywhere where things are consistently frozen throughout the winter. So zone 4 and zone 3 and below, I just don't think it's for you. Here in zone 7, buffalo grass does great. Zone 9, buffalo grass would do great. I don't know his specific climate situation or his specific soil situation. It does not love sandy soil. But if you do a soil test and you have like sandy loam, it would probably be okay. If you had like a sandy clay loam, it would definitely be okay. It really just depends. If it's primarily sand, if it's more sand than other things, I would not recommend buffalo grass. Buffalo grass thrives in clay soil, though. You could do just about as heavy clay as you want, and the buffalo grass will be fine.
Nice.
Another thing it doesn't love is consistent standing water. Like I said, it's a xeric grass. It needs almost no supplemental irrigation once it's established, which is wild when we think about how much we need to water Kentucky bluegrass, right? Mm-hmm. So if you live in a place where it really actually rains a lot, like let's just do a grass that likes water instead. I'd recommend buffalo grass for like Colorado and west, you know, maybe like the really dry parts of like Kansas that are also kind of sharing some climates with parts of Colorado, but like that part and west, if you get rain, some fine fescues and clover are going to be fine.
Awesome. All right. Amanda Staples, 44, wants to know what lawn alternative would be good for a dog who runs around like crazy and destroys the current grass.
Oh, well, I have a couple of different answers for you. The answer that is not controversial is, the less controversial answer is you're just gonna want a nice like biodiverse mix in order to make it really resilient underfoot. So you could do a mix of fescues, which still give you that like low maintenance, low water, but you're gonna wanna make sure that there's other things in there. Now, I guess maybe this is a controversial, man, they're both controversial, Lee. Oh. Because yarrow, if you Google it, It says it's toxic to dogs. Mm. But guess what? I looked for the academic papers that said that, couldn't find them. For legal reasons, I'm not going to tell you it's not
right.
toxic to dogs, obviously. For legal reasons, that is not what I just said. But hypothetically, if a student who hyperfixates on these things had gone to her landscaping instructors and asked them if Yarrow was toxic to dogs and if she should be concerned about it, hypothetically, they all said, no, absolutely not.
Well, in Salt Lake City here, we have Yarrow being planted by the city mm-hmm. in a lot of areas that have new landscaping. Yeah. So you don't think they would want to put that in if it's toxic to people's dogs?
Yeah, that is absolutely true. When you Google it, it comes up immediately gotcha. That it's toxic to dogs. So I'm never going to tell a client to do it. I'm going to say, here's the facts. You can make your own decision as a dog owner. My dog personally does not chomp on plants that way. And from what I can tell, the sheer quantity that would need to be consumed would be... Anyway, we're getting into the weeds here.
So use caution.
Use caution. If your dog eats everything in sight, maybe better safe than sorry. But I still have yet to actually find the academic paper that says you're always toxic to dogs. So that's option one. A really robust biodiverse mix. And honestly, I would have a little bit of bluegrass in there because it holds up to foot traffic. However, there are varieties that are not just your run-of-the-mill Kentucky bluegrass. There's a variety with the name that's in quotes at the end is Diva. So we just call it Diva bluegrass. And it's surprisingly drought tolerant. Still nothing like a fescue, nothing like buffalo grass, but a notable increase in drought tolerance from like a standard Kentucky blue. So a mix of a Diva bluegrass and some clover, and I mean, I would do the Yarrow, but if your dog eats literally everything in sight, you should use your judgment. That's a great option. The option two, which was the one that I thought was going to be controversial before I realized I'd have to talk about Yarrow, is this thing called dog tough grass. Mm-hmm. And at this point, they really should be paying me money because I've made several videos about it and they've all gone viral. And I'm pretty sure I sold them out of grass. And this is just this one company. So I'm like, hey, are you out there? Because we should work something out. Anyway, it's this company called, they're partnered with High Country Gardens. I don't remember the name of the actual company right now, but they sell dog tough grass. That's DOG space TUFF. And what they did was they took a strain of African Bermuda grass that would technically be a noxious weed, but they sterilized it. So it cannot go to seed anymore. Now, the reason I say this is controversial and you have to make your own decisions as a homeowner is that it does spread by runners still. So if you are living in a place with a really delicate ecosystem, please use your judgment. But if you're in an urban environment like this and like you have hardy native plants like Yarrow and like we talked about building around, I think it would be perfectly fine. It's sterilized, it cannot go to seed, it's not gonna spread across the neighborhood. This grass has all of the qualities I mentioned about buffalo grass in that it is completely xeric and does not need to be mowed. It is a warm season grass just like buffalo grass. Except it has the foot traffic tolerance like nothing I have ever seen. You could literally have professional football players on this grass all day, every day, and it is not going nowhere. You can have a pack of huskies on this grass, and it's not going nowhere. And it was literally designed for this. It was designed because the botanist who developed it had a lot of dogs, but understood that Kentucky bluegrass was stupid. So she's like, how do I do this? And then she made dog tough grass.
Literally dog tough
it's
grass.
Great. Now, because this is fun gossip, this is juicy gossip, because African Bermuda grass, this strain, is a noxious weed, right? Technically, dog tough grass is still on the noxious weed list for, well, just that, whatever that African Bermuda grass is. These books are in my way now. I need to put them away. Here they go. Anyway, because that's on the list, dog tough grass is technically illegal in the state of Utah.
Ooh.
And I'm not, again, hypothetically, for legal reasons, a landscape designer could tell their clients to drive across the border into Colorado. Normally you do that for a different kind of grass.
Right.
You could pick up both. It could be a very multifaceted trip. Very useful, very productive. But hypothetically, a landscape designer might have told several of her clients to drive to Colorado to put a trunk full of plugs.
That's just the rumor mill, though.
It's a rumor mill.
We don't know
for
anybody
legal
who's done
reasons.
That.
I do not know her.
Gotcha.
Person who did that.
Gotcha. We had another question from Wilbur and King. What is the optimal height to set the mower blade to support yarrow and clover?
Oh, that is such a great question. 2 to 4 inches. Yep.
Perfect.
If you mow it once a month, you'll maintain a lawn growth between 2 and 4 inches. Three inches is perfect.
Wait, you're saying I can plant a lawn alternative that I only have to mow once a month?
That's what I'm telling you. No, that's what I'm telling you. Yeah. Do we want to get into why the grass? They want you to have to maintain it every week because it makes people money, because it funds the multi-billion-dollar lawn care industry, and because you have to now buy a lawnmower and a lawn edger and all of the other stuff you got to buy, the fertilizers, for example. Or you have to pay a landscaping crew to come by once a week and very hurriedly. I don't know if we've ever seen landscape crews do this. It's like they are in and out of there in like 10 minutes.
Yep.
And then they charge you your $40 or $50 or whatever they charge you and they're gone. All of that is why Kentucky bluegrass is so popular, because it continues to fund this multi-billion-dollar industry. But yes, there are varieties of lawn where you either never have to mow them ever again, or like that Eco Lawn Blend that we've been talking about so often because it's a fabulous one. It's a once a month mow.
Wow.
And you're maintaining 2 to 4 inches in height on that.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
All right. Do all grass alternatives die or go brown in the freezing cold winter areas? And that's from Veghead Chrissy.
Nope. That is just warm season grasses. So we've already talked a little bit about the difference between cool season grasses and warm season grasses. It's basically about when they are dormant and when they are not. Warm season grasses, that includes the dark tuft grass, Bermuda grass, I think Zoysia, I always never know how to pronounce that one, and the buffalo grass. Those are warm season grasses. They go dormant in the winter. And the most important thing you need to know if you choose one, because I do think they're fabulous, is you need to have enough sun in that early spring time for the buffalo grass to break dormancy. And remember, in the summer in Utah, where I live, for example, the sun is at something like 70 something degrees in the air. In the winter, it's at 20 something degrees in the air. So the amount of available light you have is significantly less. So you can't look at your sky in the summer and decide you have full sun.
Right.
You need to make sure you have 6+, and honestly, like 8+ would be better, of hours in March, in April, so that buffalo grass or that warm season grass can break dormancy. That's very important, or else you're just going to have gray grass year round. Nobody wants that.
I noticed living in the Pacific Northwest that the lawns tend to be dormant in the summer and more vibrant and green during the winter.
That is a cool season grass.
Yeah.
And so Kentucky bluegrass is a cool season grass. And the part where this all breaks down is that because we as a society have valued a green grass, instead of just letting our lawns go dormant in the summer, we water them to oblivion. And so we spend billions of gallons of water. In fact, 60% of the potable drinking water in the Western United States goes to irrigating lawns because we're refusing to allow cool season grasses to go dormant. And that's another thing people don't really realize, is when they stop watering their lawn, they're not killing their lawn. Their lawn is just dormant. And if you started a week, a daily water, it will take quite a bit of water to wake it up from dormancy. But if you started irrigating it heavily tomorrow, it's going to wake back up. You haven't killed it. It's just sleeping.
You just put it to sleep.
Because it's a cool season grass.
Okay. Josie Buquez. Hi, we want to plant clover, but we now have grass. Is it enough to just plow the grass and sow the seeds, and when is the best time in the year to do so?
Oh, great. So by plow, does she mean till, do we think?
I think so.
So till. I wouldn't even bother tilling it. I would just core it, aerate it, and overseed it like we've been talking about. You could technically till, but you're just destroying soil structure unnecessarily. I'd say at that point, just run a sod cutter instead of a tiller. And then you can compost the sod, or, I mean, you could take it to a landfill, but I've also heard of people, you could straight up sell the sod, because folks want sod. So get on Nextdoor or Craigslist or whatever the day before, say, does anybody want this sod? And then you can sod cut it and take it right over to them for some money. And then I would seed the clover then. If you haven't been watching this entire video though, do clover and something else.
So there are championship golf courses that are mixing clover in with their lawns. So
I love that because it's biodiversity.
Mm-hmm.
I was up at Murray Park last summer and I looked down and I saw clover and yarrow in the lawn and it was everywhere. And my theory is that the gardeners stopped washing their mowers and that they brought it in accidentally. But it was so refreshing to see a public park have like a biodiverse turf grass, and it's honestly going to thrive so much more.
Well, it makes sense because we were told to cut down on our watering. So if the park is cutting down on the watering, maybe even unintentionally.
No, but what I would love is if somebody was smart enough to actually sow the clover and the yarrow intentionally in order to cut down on the watering, because that's exactly what it would do.
Right.
So I really, really hope that that's the case, because that would be like, that would be delightful.
Another question on Instagram. Mm-hmm. Do you have a favorite grass and wildflower combination?
Oh, I love this question. My favorite wildflower combination is one that's native to you. So I can't really give you one because I don't know where you're from, but I love, I'm going to talk Utah because that's what I know.
Mm-hmm.
I love lupine because guess what it is? Nitrogen fixing, right? So a lupine clover grass mix, absolutely gorgeous. And then we have a wildflower here called Rocky Mountain Columbine. Absolutely phenomenal, beautiful. But there are amazing wildflower seed mixes that are like Western wildflower seed mixes or whatnot. I believe it is Twin City Seed that worked with San Francisco in Bloom, who is also on TikTok and Instagram if you want to some fun content about native plants. They work together on a Western bee lawn. So if you live in the Western United States, I actually have some that I need to sow this year. They sent it to me last year, but then our frost came like 4 weeks early.
Right.
I was like, whoops, I can't do it, sorry. that's if you live in the Western United States, they have a Western bee low-mow lawn that's a mix of fescues, and then it also has all of those Western native wildflowers in it.
And obviously good for bees. Gotcha.
So is clover. If you let it flower, they love it. But in general, the best thing for bees are native flora. I was going to say fauna, but bees are the fauna.
And cut out the Roundup.
No Roundup!
Right. We don't want it. All right. We have a question here. Got a pet-friendly suggestion for grass ground cover that grows well with wild violets, strawberry, and with clover, zone 6B.
Oh, that sounds beautiful.
It does.
I love strawberry as a ground cover. I really do. And wild violets would be amazing. I would honestly just sow some low-growth fescue seed as well as additional native wildflower seeds, because that sounds lovely. Clearly you are okay. If you have clover and strawberry and violets, you're okay with like textural differences. So embrace it and get a native wildflower seed mix and then add a low grow fescue. Creeping red fescue is native to the majority of the United States. Again, I don't know where you're from, but that would be a good one.
Okay.
And again, Twin City seeds if you live in the Midwest, PT lawn seeds if you live on the West Coast are great resources for you.
That's all the questions.
Awesome. Is anybody there?
Yeah, we've got folks here watching.
Ask me more questions.
All right, if anybody has any questions, we'll be on here for a few more minutes. Do you want to just drop some grass knowledge while we're talking?
Drop some grass knowledge. I mean, that's a lot of knowledge.
Yeah, well, we've been going here for close to an hour.
Have we?
With our first grass session, yeah.
What?
So, yeah, there's some deep knowledge there.
I'm like a cannon. I'm a cannon to this. I feel great.
That's good.
If there aren't any other questions, I mean, that was a lot of information.
Absolutely. So if folks have questions they want to ask for our next live stream, how would they ask those questions?
Absolutely. So you could, I would say email me, honestly, because Instagram DMs are a dark place. I don't know if you know about that. It's hard to keep track of. My email is daryl@yardfarmer.co. You can send me an email if you'd like. My website is yardfarmer.co. I'm yardfarmer.co on all the platforms, including Instagram and the internet in general. Reach out if you have any more questions about your lawn. I am also, and this is important, we are launching a Discord server next week, hopefully, fingers crossed, to walk people through the process. Again, bubblies, sorry. to walk people through the process of replacing a Kentucky bluegrass lawn with a more ecologically eco-friendly version. So if you want an invite to that Discord server, there is a sign-up link on the link in my profile. So I would mosey on over there and pop your email address in, because we're going to send out those email or those invites next week. We also have a YouTube channel that we just launched that I would really, really appreciate anybody watching to go over and click and subscribe. We're going to be putting out at least one long-form video, fingers crossed, right, Lee?
Yeah.
Fingers crossed, yeah. We're going to be putting out one long-form video a week and then a bunch of short forms where we're going really in-depth in the process of replacing lawns with native landscapes. We are sod cutting a friend's lawn for her. We're going along with some clients that we're solarizing, some clients that we're overseeding, and then my own yard, I'm actually sheet mulching in order to replace with a native food forest this year.
Cool.
All of which we are going to be documenting on the YouTube. So I'd strongly, strongly recommend you head on over there.
Big time education format there for us.
Yes.
All right. One final question. This is also from Wilbur and King. What is the best grass for hay harvesting in Connecticut?
I have no idea. That is so niche.
Yeah, that's very niche.
I actually don't know. I can't even BS my answer for that.
I'm assuming CT is Connecticut.
Yeah.
It's been a while since I had to look at my state codes. Okay.
No, I mean, I usually only recommend residential lawns, and we always do fescue blend on the East Coast. Sorry, I don't know. I've never harvested hay.
Oh, there's always time.
What a great note to end on. Just a flat out, I don't know.
But at least you didn't BS your way through it.
No, so. I'm not going to pretend to know anything about hay harvesting. I don't know nothing about that.
All right. Well, that does it for us tonight.
Is that it?
That's it.
That feels bad.
No.
To end on. But all right.
Well, okay. So we could come up with another quick question. I've heard that doing bark mulch in a yard is actually really good for the actual soil health over time, that breaks down and, mm-hmm. and makes for a really, is that true?
Yeah. Okay. It's the same kind of conversation we had about carbon versus nitrogen. But the main reason that bark mulch in general on just as a top dressing is so good for the lawn is that it really helps with water retention, because all of the bark acts as like a sponge. And it absorbs the water and then will significantly reduce the amount of water you need to keep a native landscape or a garden or anything cool. So I strongly recommend mulching with a natural bark mulch. And to get really specific about this, the heated, screened, treated, dyed stuff, garbage. Hot garbage. When it's like screened and it's dyed like black or brown, yes, it looks nice, but the only value you have is aesthetic. Because once it's heated to that temperature, all of the beneficial microbes, all of the beneficial bacteria, fungi, they're gone. And you just have something pretty. And honestly, because in my landscapes, we like to plant out really lush landscapes where not a lot of soil is exposed, there's truly no value in a dyed or screened bark mulch. I also don't like mulching with straw, because more often than not, you will end up getting invasive weed seeds mm-hmm. in your garden brought in through the straw. And so for biosecurity, straw and hay and those kinds of things are not my favorite for mulching. An unscreened natural bark mulch is. And so an arborist wood chip is really the way to go. Two ways you can go about this. One, you can sign up for Chip Drop, which is a free service connecting arborists with people who want wood chips. The caveat of this is that they will drop off literally as much as they want. And it could be a literal mountain. It could be a dump truck full of wood chips. That has happened to me. It was fine because I needed a lot of wood chips. It was okay. But just, you have to be prepared. You have to have a spot in your driveway or something available. And you also, you can select, like, if you absolutely don't want a certain type. I always say no tree of heaven, because I do not trust that those chips will not somehow become trees of heaven.
Right.
Which are the bane of my existence. Mm-hmm. And I always say no black walnut, because they have allelopathic qualities. Allelopathic means they actually can prevent or stunt the growth of other plants. So I say no tree of heaven, no black walnut. And then I also usually just say no pests or fungal diseases. Fingers crossed that the arborist cares enough to not drop that off. So that's option one. Option two would be to get an electric wood chipper and then actually use the own biomass produced on your property to create mulch, which is one of my favorite things to do. And in a permaculture design, I actually design or put in plants that are met, the yield of those plants are their own biomass. So we'll have a hedgerow of nitrogen fixing trees that grow very quickly, that once a year the client can prune and mulch in just an electric wood chipper that you get on like Sunjo or from Home Depot or whatever, and then use that as the top dressing for their garden annually, and then it grows back the next year, and you're creating a closed loop system, which is gorgeous. And bonus points if they're nitrogen fixing trees, because not only are they fixing nitrogen into the soil, but they're also storing nitrogen in their biomass, and then you're putting free fertilizer on the ground when you spread the wood chips. It's gorgeous and beautiful, and I love it so much.
Amazing. Mm-hmm. You ready for one more question?
Hell yeah, I am.
All right. How many wildflowers can one really expect to thrive together in a habitat?
I mean, the limit does not exist.
They won't choke each other out? They won't overcompete each other?
Well, I mean, it's, who's to say, right? Because if you're putting down a wildflower seed mix, you're going to have a whole biodiverse ecosystem happening. And that's going to be gorgeous and beautiful. So I guess I don't quite understand the question, because if you're trying to plant every single wildflower that ever existed, that's not going to work. But if you get a meadow mix, like PT Lawn Seeds has a native meadow mix, which is great for the Pacific Northwest in particular, but there are also, you know, if you just Google like Utah native wildflower mix or whatever, and you spread that, the amount that's going to come up is going to be gorgeous and satisfactory. I actually spread some wildflower seeds in along like this empty garden bed that I had last fall, and I see them germinating right now, so I'm gonna have that entire, it's a huge rectangular strip, probably 30 feet long, along the edge of my garden, that's just gonna grow up and be this sort of wild, messy mix of pollinator supporting plants, and I'm totally cool with that.
Which we need.
So I would say just get a mix that's truly native to where you live, and I really do mean that, because if you just say wildflower mix, it's gonna have a bunch of random European wildflowers in it. And it might have milkweed that's not native to your region. And it's really important that the milkweed plants that you plant are native to exactly where you live, because the cycle of milkweed growing and then dying back is what triggers the migratory patterns of monarch butterflies. And so if you have a milkweed planted that isn't native to your exact region, then the migratory pattern is gonna get thrown off. And that's bad. So native all the way, my friends.
All the way.
All the way.
All right. Drop the contact one more time and we'll sign off.
Heck yeah. This was fun. I mean, obviously it was fun. Okay. I'm Daryl. I'm a sustainable landscape designer at yardfarmer.co. And you can find me at yardfarmer.co across all platforms, including YouTube, which is brand new thanks to my good friend Lee, who is sitting right here behind the camera. Please subscribe to that, because we could use all the help we could get at this point. We're just little bebes.
Just babies.
Just little bebes. Yep. And my website is also yardfarmer.co. I'm trying to keep it simple for you.
Yeah.
Trying to keep it simple. And I bought, using too much money, yardfarmer.com, because I figured that y'all would make that mistake. So now if you type in yardfarmer.com, you'll end up at the same place.
Which I learned the hard way.
But I had to like be in negotiations with some guy in like Tulsa for like weeks. And he was hardballing me.
Yeah. Hardcore.
Okay, that's it. Bye.